Hey everyone!
It is another What We Read episode.
That's
today.
Right. Keeping good time, keeping it nice and sweet.
Trying to keep it
short
nice and
sweet.
Short and sweet. We'll see if we can do that here because this video is one where I, at least, am talking about books I really enjoy.
Yeah, exactly. All the bizarre reads are kind of done, and these are the ones that are like, we really love this stuff.
And all of my books are fantasy books. Which is very exciting.
And all of mine are fantasy books,
wow,
too.
Wow, it's like we planned it.
It's like we turned out. It's like, you got yours, I got mine, let's do this.
Mm-hmm.
We just sort of grouped them together and make it happen. Anyway, but enough about our process.
Let's get into the books so that we can keep it short and sweet. The first one I'm going to talk about is an audiobook that I actually borrowed from the library. I've been curious about this adult fantasy title since I first heard about it. It's called The Bone Shard Daughter, and it's by Andrea Stewart, I want to say, is her last name. I'm sorry if I got that wrong. The book cover is going to be here.
Cool.
Anyway, this is a multiple perspective fantasy novel set in a world that has a lot of Asian cultural influences, or that's what it feels like to me. And it has three different perspectives. As far as I can remember, it's three. The first one is a sort of, he's a reluctant aide to sort of rebellious acts of treason against
sure.
the all-powerful government. There is another woman in the story who happens to be sort of a governor's daughter, and her, you know, life has always been a certain way for her, and she's kind of used to that. She does want to improve it, but you know, she doesn't really see too much of an issue with the old way of life. And then the third perspective is the daughter of the emperor, who is competing with his foster son to become the heir of the empire.
Sure.
And in this world, the magic is centered on bone magic.
Nice.
And every citizen is required to donate a shard of their own bone.
Ugh.
Because the emperor, who is the only one who can do it, uses that to craft bone creatures, bone structure, like bone, all sorts of things.
That's just...
It's very messed up.
Oh man, I don't know how you...
Yeah.
Oh.
Anyway, what I really liked, well, actually, funnily enough, the magical aspect of it I found fascinating. It was disturbing. For sure, because the more you use someone's bone shard in whatever you're using, the faster they die. Because obviously, you're like tapping into their
life force.
Yeah, life force. But I like the combination of that set against a backdrop where there was a lot of political unrest and rebellious sort of undertones. And I think it's one of those fantasy stories where it's a lot of like, there is a certain person in power, they're the only ones granted the gift or this ability, and they are misusing it. Or not using it to the benefit of everyone else. And so obviously people are starting to rise up and rebel against that because they either don't want to be controlled or they feel like they should be treated more fairly. And I love stories like that. Like, I find them fascinating if you manage to weave all of those elements in together. I really like that the audiobook is narrated by three different people because it's so much easier to keep track of who is who. Like, at the beginning it was a little confusing because you kind of get thrown right into it and you're just like, what's happening? Like, who is this person? What is the context? All of that good stuff. But like, once I figured it all out, sort of, and sorted it in my head, it became easier to follow along. I do have a favorite perspective. I won't tell you who, so you're not biased. But I will say, like, overall, it all comes together very well. I think it's a well-constructed story. It has a lot of great elements, and she did a really good job making it super compelling and super interesting. And I'm very curious to see where it's going to go next because of the way it ends, too. Because the ending is super solid, and I was like, it could technically just end there.
But,
and yet it doesn't.
And yet it doesn't.
Yeah, so it was a really strong fantasy debut novel. Definitely an adult novel for a reason, because there is no holding back when it comes to the brutality that happens in the books. So definitely check it out if you're interested. I would highly recommend it personally. The next book I'm going to talk about is also a debut novel, and I'm very excited about it because I had high hopes going into it, and luckily it lived up to my expectations. So the book is These Violent Delights by Chloe Gong, and this is the one I mentioned it before, where it is set against the backdrop of 1920s Shanghai,
sure.
And it is a Romeo and Juliet type story.
So
the two main characters are Juliet Kai and Roma Montagov, and they are from two rival gang families who are trying to, you know, keep the power within their own possession, except that they end up having to team up because there is a mystical murderous force afoot in Shanghai that is messing with everyone. And so, shenanigans ensue, basically. And I really love this book. I loved all the nods to Romeo and Juliet in it. I love the 1920s setting in Shanghai, which I've never read before. I enjoyed the characters a lot. Juliet is absolutely my favorite because she is just one badass heroine who also has like that vulnerable, like,
she's not
spirit
14.
In there. I love it. I enjoyed it so much. There is a lot of like fighting and violence and sort of crappy things that happened in this story, for sure. Not gonna condone any of that, obviously. But it was entertaining. Plus, it also has the magical mystery aspect of it, and you guys know that I enjoy like a good magical murder mystery. So all in all, the combination was just so well done, and I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I cannot believe she wrote this, or wrote a draft of it when she was 18. Like, how to be you? Please teach me your ways. Like, I think it's so great, and it's so fun.
Talented people.
And this book reminded me yet again that I do really like YA historical fantasy books. I think they can be super enjoyable and super fun, and I really would love to continue to see a diverse array of characters and settings for them. And I'm so excited for book two, because the last, like, I think it was like 70-ish pages, I couldn't read at first because I was really stressed out, because I was like, I kind of, like, based on like how Romeo and Juliet ends, obviously my mind was like, it can't end like that, it can't, please.
And yet
it was still, it doesn't end the way you think it will, but it's still traumatizing. And I'm just like, this is terrible, but also great. And like, it hurts so good.
Hurts so good.
So that's, yeah, I really enjoyed this book. I would highly recommend checking it out as well. Alright, I think that's your turn.
Alrighty.
Chatting.
Let's kick it off with another Kindle Unlimited read that I managed to stumble upon. It's called Dragonseed. It's about three volumes of this. Dragonseed is set in a world where there is a sort of like a pact between humans and dragons and
sure.
elves and forget dwarves, I think. Typical fantasy mainstays. And the dragons actually have the ability to sire sort of halflings amongst, you know, like the other sort of like bipedal races, right?
Okay.
It centers around one particular guy who is the son of a particularly old curmudgeon-y dragon, the black dragon. Things are set into motion when the dragon's tear, his dad, dragons only shed a tear once, is sort of lost somewhere, and he
oh,
has
no.
to find it, and it's necessary for a particular machine that is critical to the prosperity of all the races combined in the known world, and the
that
loss of
sounds
this,
like fun.
Yeah, it is, and the loss of this tier will throw that entire society into chaos if they don't do it. However, he's like, but there's more to this than that, and there's a lot of intrigue underneath, and you even get to into the history of, well, what really went down between the humans and the dragons back in the day. And it's just a fun romp. And you know, he's you know, since his dad is an acid dragon, so his draconic breath is acidic, so it's a little bit of a nod to D&D, sort of kind of acid breath, fire breath, depending on who your parents are and what's your draconic tell kind of deal. So that was fun. Highly recommend if you just want a nice shut your brain off, read a nice cute little story, fantasy story. Which leads me to, I want to say, a really really cool trifecta of Magic the Gathering books that I didn't plan on reading in the same breath, but ended up reading it anyway because one of them just came out. It's called Magic the Gathering Legends, A Visual History of, you know, Magic the Gathering, where they basically take the best art from across, you know, year, like the last decade or so of Magic the Gathering playing cards, and tell sort of the stories behind each and every card for each and every single sort of like plane or universe within the multiverse. And it's lovely because you get to review all of the stuff that you sort of love, all of the play, you know, the stories in the planes. But what's interesting is because, you know, in the last couple of years, a plot line called War of the Spark finally came to a head, where an evil elder dragon decides to, you know, be angry at the fact that he had lost his godhood, mm-hmm. decides to go, I'm gonna get it back, and launches the most bananas plan in the whole world. And because he's ancient, he's a step ahead of every single hero. So War of the Spark is a combination of everything I love about Magic the Gathering in one awesome story that has a plot, combining these favorite things. We've got, I almost want to do this in Stefan's voice, this book has everything. Elder dragons, planeswalkers.
I mean, you could.
Jaya Ballard, task mage. You know what I mean? That guy who always gets lost and ends up on, you know, whatever. Anyway, but it's just so, and it does have Jaya Ballard. It combines Ravnica, which is my favorite thing of all time
in really
Magic
is.
Gathering. It combines the Gatewatch, which is a story about a bunch of friends who are like, we have power, we must defend the world, and they're the only ones trying to fight against the evil elder dragon, Nicol Bolas. And then it's got a lot of characters from the other Magic the Gathering timelines that just sort of end up in this war against this dragon, and it's this beautiful, beautiful chess game. The entire first book happens within the span of a day, very Avengers Endgame, right?
That's
got
sense.
That feels. Cuts straight to War of the Spark Forsaken, which is literally a great prologue. It is, I'm sorry, a great epilogue. What happens right after the it p- picks up immediately after the events of that, and it ties sort of everybody's stories together, everybody's arcs together, and I cried. I did. It was just me and my friend saved the world again.
Your fave.
And I just get so many feels because this is the culmination of a lot of story arcs that sort of close before the new chapters begin for everybody. Highly recommend it to any Magic the Gathering fans. I've seen some bad reviews of Forsaken, and I'm like, I liked it so much. So maybe that's just me. I'm like a different sort of subset of like the fan base that are just like, that was amazing, give me more. And that was it. So.
Good job being succinct. That's great. All right, two more books, and they both sort of have a Greek mythology bent, which is pretty cool. One is unfortunately an upcoming release, so you're not going to be able to get your hands on it until January 2021.
Get my hands on it. Sorry.
That book is Lore by Alexandra Bracken. This is her latest novel. It's a standalone, and it is inspired by Greek mythology.
Yes.
The story centers around the main character, who is also named Lore. Her full name is Melora Perseus.
And hell yeah.
She lives in a world where every 7 years, there is a thing called the Aegon. It's basically like a competition where 9 gods are made human, and there are certain family lines who hunt them down in order to get a chance at immortality and, you know, god-like powers. And so Lore has decided to no longer participate in this because during the last Aegon, her entire family was slaughtered and she's the only survivor.
That's terrible.
But unfortunately for her, there are 2 individuals who sort of end up pulling her back into the current Aegon. There is Castor, who is a childhood friend of hers that she thought had died a long time ago.
Oh, hello.
And who has resurfaced. And then there is the goddess Athena, who offers her an alliance so that she can kill the person who killed her family.
Oh, man.
So this book was just as good as I was hoping it would be. I have a soft spot for stories that incorporate Greek mythology. I haven't read a lot of them recently that are not part of the Rick Riordan line of stories, and even those I'm not caught up on, but it was just so fascinating to see someone else's take on them, especially the way Alex wrote it. Because she set it up so that there are very high stakes right off the bat, and you know this, and it doesn't let up the entire way through.
Ooh, very nice.
And I admire that so much. I love that there are no, like, you know, there's no holding back when it comes to the brutality of this story, when it comes to the different things that happen, which mirror a lot of what Greek mythology is like.
Anyway.
If you really think about it. And I also really like that set in New York. I mean, I'll admit that it was part of the charm for me because, you know, I love New York. I live in New York and work in New York, so
New York,
it's fun to read that.
Greek myths.
And then I was telling Mackie when I told him about this book, another thing I really enjoyed is the character work. So there's Lore, who I love to pieces. I think she's great. She is angry and defiant. There is a vulnerability to her that she keeps trying to hide, and she's trying to get away from this world that hurt her so badly that she no longer wants to subscribe to, basically, their, like, way of living. But she's kind of reeled back in, and she's forced to make some tough choices, and I just admire that so much about her. I also like that there is a whole group of characters that you kind of get to know and love. I do wish we'd seen them a little more, but this is essentially, at its heart, Lore's story. And that's really the main focal point of it. The action is very solid all throughout. Every single section of this book ends with some sort of, you know, continual inciting incident. So it just makes the next part even higher stakes and higher stakes and
progressive complications.
Yeah, so it's so good. It's so cinematic. That's another thing that I really liked about it. It felt like I was watching a movie like the entire time I was reading it, which I don't know if that makes sense to anyone else, but like sometimes
that's how I read all the time.
Yeah, sometimes when I'm reading I don't actually visualize as well. This one, it was like right off the bat I could see everything happening, and it was really great. So definitely highly recommend pre-ordering this one if you haven't already. It's so good. Hopefully Mackie will read it and love it too. But speaking of books that have like a Greek mythology sort of bent to them, I finally read a book that came out in 2017. I've had it since 2017.
Since 2017.
But I finally read it, and that is Wonder Woman Warbringer by Leigh Bardugo. I actually listened to the audiobook of this one. And can I just say, it's funny because at the beginning of this one, I already really enjoyed it because I love Teen Diana a lot, and just encountering her at the beginning, seeing her own insecurity about her place on the island of Themyscira, and sort of trying to figure out who she wants to be and how to reconcile that with all she's known growing up, is fascinating. And then to throw her in the path of Aaliyah, who is the girl she rescues from certain death when the boat is like sinking near Themyscira, and that drastically changes the course of both of their lives forever, because Aaliyah is a warbringer, which
Let's just like just take a moment to like it's please it's a shout out to Leigh Bardugo's lore building here, because a Warbringer just happens to be the girl who in her blood is the, you know, some kind of like force or some kind of chaotic power that throws the world out into on its axis.
There's an imbalance that causes a lot of chaos, basically starts a war, like, you know, Helen of Troy.
Helen of Troy was a Warbringer, and I'm like, what?
It was so fascinating. The lore is actually one of the best parts of this book too, aside from the characters, because it's just so well done. Like, it's just so perfectly constructed, and I think she did an incredible job with that. It was funny, because at the beginning, and I think I might have started saying this earlier but got disrupted, I was telling Megan, like, I do enjoy the book, but I was starting to feel like, oh, it's like the typical superhero stories, and I kind of know what's gonna happen, and that always doesn't always work for me.
Yeah.
And then at some point I was like, no! There's too many things happening that I did not see coming.
It was once great. Again, Leigh Bardugo
Once
on
again,
brand.
Leigh Bardugo is thwarting all my feels, thwarting all my plans, and I flipping love this book. I think it's incredible, and she did such a great job with the characters, with the lore, with the story. Everything about this book was just pure delightful, and I'm so happy I finally read it. It is a stellar, stellar book, and I would highly recommend checking it out if you haven't already.
Beautiful.
That brings us to the end of this very exciting
That's
video where we talk
right.
about great things.
Yeah, it was fun. All the weird stuff is gone, and now we're just
all
the
good
stuff
fantasy
that we really
stuff.
Just enjoyed all this stuff. So if you all have read this stuff, if you're playing Magic, holler at me. I'm playing Magic again.
Do let us know what you've been reading. If you're excited about any of the books, if you want to talk more lore and get more deets on that, happy to oblige. And we will see you guys with a new video next week. Bye.